Ladies and gentlemen, we are here in Oakland, California at the Oracle Arena celebrating the 11th season of the Intel Extreme Masters Finals. And as you guys have seen, we have had an incredible weekend with some very matches that we kind of expected, but most of the matches, we had no idea of the outcomes. And I can tell you guys, we have been watching, screaming up and down with the hearts pumping out of our chests watching these matches. And I can assure you, these next few matches are going to be just the same. And now, to introduce our first team, the LMS Spring and Summer Champions, the Flash Wolves! And now let's welcome back the European team who is making their debut in this series, Unicorns of Love!
Flash Wolves, and they brought out the unicorn hats. I couldn't be happier. They're totally in the atmosphere.
True power is coming out now, and we really get to see what they can show in the best of five, which is really where you're tested, and you can really tell which team is best.
They're not going to play with the hats on? What is this?
It's all about the synergy, so they're just going to set up. I know yesterday they had them sitting on top of the computers and everything, so that was pretty nice, but maybe they'll do that again. Yeah. But otherwise, I'm also disappointed they don't have the hats
on. Well, just as an aside, they probably don't want anything disturbing them, because this is a huge moment for both of these teams. A big story coming into the tournament was all the teams that are attending not meeting their goals. They have to prove something. They have to make a statement. And now both the Flash Wolves, after that not getting through to past the group stage at Worlds, and the Unicorns of Love, after not even making it, can win an international tournament. That is huge.
And the other side of that is also kind of the development and the long journeys that both these teams have been on. It's not just the failed expectations, but, you know, can the Flash Wolves now close out in a late game? Can the Unicorns of Love play more than just one style, or fall back to that game kind of reputation that they have? And so far for the Unicorns of Love, the answer has been yes. Jury's still out on Flash Wolves.
And we have to remember that the winner here will advance to IEM Katowice, so get another chance to really play against even stronger competition and really say we're kind of the best in the world at this point. We're the best in our region, at least to some extent, which is really quite the prestige. And I think that that makes them, makes these teams just have so much more pressure on the line and just really focus down, especially for the Unicorns, who really got a good chance of looking at the Flash Wolves and scout them out.
Yeah, I mean, both of these teams have an immense amount that they want to prove, you know, not only just to us, but to themselves, because Flash Wolves, of course, as we mentioned it, having a really rough time at the group stage, not making it out, a really pretty dismal performance at Worlds as far as they are concerned. And then Unicorns, a playoff team that never made it to Worlds. So to be on this stage now and have the chance to win, Unicorns.
Romance going all out.
The manager's throwing out jerseys. I'll take one over here. How about that? No, that was supposed to be mine. All right, I didn't catch it. But anyway. They have a lot to prove to themselves, because they want to have that confidence, especially for a team like Flash Wolves that has Double Red starting on this roster. This could mean a lot to him. Starting his professional career here at IEM and winning in the finals, that would be massive.
Yeah, definitely. So let's take a look at the rest of the lineup, or the roster rather. For the Flash Wolves, it will be unchanged as what we just saw. MMD is staying up in that top lane as a start, at least. Karsa in the jungle, then Maple, Double Red, as you mentioned, and Sword Art, the staple, absolute staple of that lineup. Interesting that we haven't seen any variation yet, but they haven't needed it yet to bring in Rins to show him the ropes. This might be a good opportunity.
Yeah, well, it makes sense. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. Yep. And MD had a really good game on the NAR, and he was just capable of being a solid voice through the team and making sure that everyone stays calm and collected, which is such an important thing to do in hectic games.
And let's take a look at their opponents, the Unicorns of Love. No subs for them here, so they will also be starting with the same lineup. Vizichachi in the top lane, in the jungle it's Move, Exile, RG Fuel, MVP in the mid lane, Veritas, and Hillisock holding down that bottom lane. And something also very interesting from the side of the Unicorns of Love, they've been to three IEMs now, but they've never played international team that isn't from NA or a wildcard region. So now going up against this LMS team and being able to scrim them will be very important, not only for this match, but also for their future going forward and the beginning of the EULCS, sticking that team together.
Yeah, I think that I think it's going to be an interesting matchup. I mean, these guys, they mentioned that they have been scrimming each other, which makes sense because they're on the opposite side of the brackets, but now they get to meet in the finals. So hopefully they didn't reveal too much to each other during those scrims. But I mean, if we've learned anything about the Unicorns of Love, it's that they have a lot of things up their sleeve. But Flash Wolves as well, with Maple with his immense champion pool, I think that there's a couple things that he could pull out as well. The Aurelion Soul definitely going to be a big pick.
Yeah, thinking about picks and bans, I just think we're kind of beating a dead horse, no pun intended here, for the Unicorns. Because they have played incredibly standard, we haven't seen anything cheese, and to be honest, that hasn't been a really big part of their identity for quite a while, and I think that is a hopeful sign for them going into this final.
And that's when they've really looked best in this tournament, is when they play standard and when they fall back to kind of their macro rotations and their decision-making across the map. Their skirmishes, you know, sometimes they're still fighting at inopportune times or taking fights that aren't the best and kind of fumbling on the execution, but it's still like a 50-50 coin flop there. So if Flash Wolves are good at early game macro and kind of meh at late game team fights, and Unicorns of Love are great at mid game, late game macro, and 50-50 on team fights, I'm still going to err on the side of Unicorns.
And it's considering that even the fights that they lose tend to be on sides of the map that actually make sense. They're moving where areas matter. They're contesting Baron where they have a lead post 20 minutes. They're moving towards the bottom side of the map if they want to go for turrets, as opposed to just randomly getting caught out in places that just do not belong if you're in an advantage, in an advantageous position. And that's something that is a lot of credit towards the team, because that's the thing that while the game might be sloppy, it's still indicative of somebody that knows where they should be, which means that they have less steps to close in terms of improving their gameplay and just being very crisp.
Yeah, and a game one in a best of five series always so indicative in terms of picks and bans. I mean, we are about to jump into those picks and bans. Unicorns of Love are on the blue side for game one. We're going to see what they decide to go for in terms of their first ban. A lot of options open for them. A lot of variety we've seen from them at well in the top lane as well as in the mid lane. Four different champions played already for Exile. We have that Kassadin in the mix, and then of course the MF, the Bard, and Tom Kenshin support, so we'll see what they do. They do not want to take any risks with the Dragon. Aurelion Soul's banned out, as well as Karma, and then Syndra, of course, banned from coming out of the Flash Wolves, as well as Ryze.
Absolutely, you have to get rid of the Aurelion Soul, especially on blue side. You do not want to let them have a purple as a counter pick, which makes it so difficult for you to play the sidelines accordingly.
And this is a bit of an adaptation. You know, normally we see either Olaf or Nidalee targeted out, but this time around the Lee Sin. So we'll see if that's followed up by Flash Wolves banning the Nidalee, and then that jungle pool really becomes down to Olaf and Elise.
Yeah, we'll see what their priorities go to if they decide to do that, and what kind of a first pick they force out of the Unicorns of Love. It will be the Jhin banned out.
Jace is still up as well, and I do think that Jace might be a bigger priority, although the thing is, if you pick the Jace, you can't run it with the Nidalee. So then, yeah. Right here, if the Flash Wolves were to take the Jace, they would opt out on giving up the Nid pick, because it just doesn't make sense to have double poke composition.
Yeah, I mean, even outside of that, we have, you know, like the Cassiopeia is something that's available. The Orianna is still there, but it will be the Olaf as the first pickup for Unicorns of Love. So it seems like they don't want to go for that Nidalee. So it is an option available for Karsa. We saw him played in that first game. Wasn't the cleanest play. The game was a little bit of a clown fiesta overall, but could bring it back out. I mean, he still does have mechanical prowess with that champion. It was just the decision making really wasn't there.
Yeah, and they also don't have to show too much here. Oh, they decide to go for the Ashe. Tom Kench lane has been a pivotal pick for both Sword Art and for Hillisign.
And again, this is just kind of a denial pick that covers all of their bases. The fact that they're prioritizing the Ashe because the Jhin is banned, and then picking up the support that is able to deny Ashe her pick potential with that gobble.
Yeah, I really like how you bring that up, because they were hovering the Nidalee, and you could just take the Nidalee and say, yep, we got the great jungler already, but because the Unicorns takes the Olaf, there is no need for you to show your jungling right away, and you make sure that you take the heavy engage, that roaming global bottom lane in the Tahm Kench and the Ashe, and because the Jhin was banned, you keep that priority. So I like the ban from the Jhin, understanding that the Unicorns most likely prioritize a jungler, and you immediately clutch onto the bottom lane.
Yeah, already very interesting start, and not really anything special seen from both of these teams, with the Tahm Kench in there and the Ashe, and then the Bard is possibly what Hillisang will go to, and it seems like Caitlyn is on the board, and yes, it is for Veritas.
I thought for sure that they were going to go with the Ezreal route just because Veritas had already showed a great game on that champion, but deciding to really prioritize the shove and the lane control by having both the Caitlyn and the Bard. Very oppressive 2v2.
It's actually one of my favorite jungle combos, the Olaf and the Bard, because one of Olaf's greatest strength is that mobility, but Bard really, or not that mobility, the ability to just fight, and then Bard just helps him get that mobility. He can go over walls, he can tempered fate, and he just sits there chucking his axes in the air, just getting ready to maul. And it's so entertaining to watch this combination, especially when we saw how much focus they put into the bottom lane.
Yeah, Caitlyn, the first bit of a surprise in that draft, and now we will see what the Flash Wolves decide to go for. Nidalee is kind of a given, it seems, for that jungle pick and hovering the Poppy for the top lane.
I was really concerned for a second that they were flashing the Gangplank. I don't necessarily agree with it, although I do think he's a great champion. It's just when you see an Olaf, you really need to grab the Poppy again, not because you're disengaging the Olaf, but because you're creating and separating space between him and his enemy and his ally team.
They do decide to lock in the Nidalee and the Poppy there. No big surprises there?
It's a super solid draft already from the Flash Wolves. You know that the last pick is going to come out for Maple so that he does have that counter pick, although it's most likely going to be a control mage again because of the meta. But there's just so much CC and pick potential here. You have slamming against the wall. You have the CC from Tahm Kench and the Ashe. And when you couple that with the high DPS from a Nidalee jungling, it's very easy for you to catch somebody out of position and punish them immediately. So I like the ability to just get quick picks and then move on.
Yeah, as said, the Orianna's Exile has had a fantastic performance on as well, as paired with the Kennen for Vizicacci in the top lane. A lot of playmaking potential here again coming out of the Unicorns of Love, and now to see what Maple will prefer to take to the mid lane, although will most likely... Oh, or curveball. No, I'm getting too excited.
I told you, this guy has a champion pull, all right? So, I mean... If you look at Worlds, he probably has the second biggest champion pull under maybe Faker. So it's pretty massive.
I do not want to see a Vel'Koz here, first of all. If you put Vel'Koz against Bard, if you're Vel'Koz against Bard, you are going to get decimated. Illithan had no problem shooting that Tempered Fate and just killing Victor, which is even tougher than the Vel'Koz because he has the speed boost. Unfortunately, there's really not a whole lot of champion pull for the mid to protect yourself against Illithan.
Get out of here with your logic. We want to see that Vel'Koz in the game, but possibly will get changed here in the end to a Victor, possibly. Kaz, it's locked!
Oh, they're gonna lock it in.
Goodness.
All right. It's definitely risky, but it's got a lot of potential to just blow up the game.
I mean, if he can get fed, murdered by Illithan.
We'll see. Is this just an extreme show of confidence, or does he know something that we don't?
Well, it's an incredibly powerful duo for the jungle and mid, because Vel'Koz can push the wave so seamlessly that it allows Nidalee to go into the jungle nonstop. So if they're capable of keeping track of Olaf, making sure that they're on top of buff invades, this could work very well.
We will see. This is what they are fighting for in game one and over this best of five. It is the championship at IEM Oakland, and they're going to start it off with a Vel'Koz from the side of the Flash Wolves. Casters, take it away.
I could not be happier to be casting a Vel'Koz game in the grand finals of IEM Oakland. Thank you, everyone, for sticking it out through this day. My name is Daniel Sifa Drakos. I'm joined to what you consider my right by Aiden Zyrun Moon, and to technically my left by Christopher Papasmithy-Smith.
You got it.
It was a little slow to start, but this is it. One final best of five to see who will be our champion, who will be moving on to Katowice, and who can make a bigger name for themselves on the international stage, as Unicorns of Love haven't really won a lot of tournaments.
Well, they haven't won a single tournament. They don't actually have a trophy in their case, except for maybe a challenger one from back in the day, but that's 2 years old plus. So right now, Unicorns of Love, we're trying to look at a 2017 Unicorns of Love. They're trying to come into the next year strong, and they want that. They want to set a new precedent.
And Unicorns of Love already fired a couple of shots today. The news came to confirm their roster. They will have Vizicacci and Hillisang and the rest of the players locked in for 2017. They beat TSM. If they were to also take this tournament, be a really exciting acceleration of the hype train for Unicorns of Love in 2017.
This is it, ladies and gentlemen. Unicorns of Love on blue side in game one. Flash Wolves on the red, ready to get it underway. Vel'Koz, I think, has to be the center of attention here as we come into this. What does this champion do?
I mean, it's a really interesting pick, just because Maple sees something I don't. Laning phase could probably be pretty comfortable in the mid lane. We've got time to talk about Vel'Koz. Don't worry, ladies and gentlemen.
We needed to talk about Vel'Koz.
Thank you so much, guys. We needed
support.
This time.
We need it.
Don't make it sound like it's our fault. Come on.
You've got to embrace the situation. But the big story here is they're drafting a Vel'Koz, you know, a no escape mid laner. Has its strengths, but it's against Kennen, for example. The Kennen flank's going to be something. Any champion that can close the distance onto the Vel'Koz will make his life hell. And there's also Bard, who can do the ranged engage and the ranged interruption of the Vel'Koz ultimate. So it seems like a game where there's a lot of tools on the side of Unicorns of Love to take out Vel'Koz. So Vel'Koz, as this last pick, sure, the wave clear is going to be very safe against Orianna in lane. I just don't see what about the draft really necessitate or really encouraged a Velkos pick? I mean, Zyrene, what do you see about the Velkos?
The thing I see about it is it's mostly just, it's a good wave clear champion in the mid lane, but also they're looking at a little bit more of a poke siege composition here for themselves. They already have the Nidalee. If you can get the slow with the Vel'Koz, you're going to land the Nidalee Spear afterwards and possibly get a kill there. So the Maple Karsa synergy, there is potential for them to actually pick up a lot of kills early on a low mobility champion like the Orianna.
So that's interesting too, because if we're going to talk about early game snowballing, I'm wondering, is this the ideal champion to do it on? How strong is Vel'Koz if he gets a lead? Because, you know, we know Assassins for that potential to snowball in the mid lane. We have great, a lot of great champions to set up potential mid ganks. Is Vel'Koz the ideal pick for that circumstance, or what else does he provide aside from the potential for that early pressure?
I don't think we've ever got an answer, you know, in the history of competitive league over whether Vel'Koz the ideal champion in a specific situation. That's why I'm looking for another data point here. This is Maple, just carried on Aurelion Sol, but we've seen scarcely in the past, but we know its potential. Champion like Vel'Koz, you know, over in Korea, we had Spenu playing it a couple of times. It troubled Faker in one of those series, but actually picking up the win with so many tools that deal well against the Vel'Koz, that's the part that I don't see. I don't see the full picture here.
Exactly. The Vel'Koz may be able to do well in a little bit of a vacuum with the team composition, but it's not going to play too well into what UOL have right now if UOL end up playing it correctly. And I do actually want to talk about this bottom lane, because we actually have Veritas, Hillsang, and then Double Red, who actually had some pretty decent performances in the last two games, up against the Tahm Kench as well. So that's the Ashe-Tahm Kench combo. They took it away so that they wouldn't have the Tahm Kench on the other side to prevent the Ashe arrow. But then this is another combination on the other side. Caitlyn Bard, ulti from Bard into Caitlyn traps, a lot of damage that you'll be able to deal, and a lot of pickoff potential.
And not a great start coming in there from Double Red, tanking the early binding here, and we saw a lot of teams take the Bard away from Hillisang. It's been given over to them this time, they have it. And, you know, honestly, we saw it be very effective against a much more experienced AD carry in Wild Turtle, in Biofrost. Not experienced as a duo, but you have to wonder how Double Red's gonna stand up to the insane pick potential that comes out at level 6.
Questions upon questions, but in a best of five, I'm sure we're going to get some of the answers to the things we're wondering about. One thing you can say about Vel'Koz, the WMAX has certainly been the staple so far, just being able to instant wave clear through two Ws, pretty low risk in that way. So at least in the early game, once you get about 3 points in that Vel'Koz W, you're easily going to shove in Orianna before the Mirella Nomicon comes out for that Ori.
A lot of aggressive trading on the top side. Chachi has the luxury of range, but MMD's not done chasing him down yet. It's just going to back off in the end, but normally we expect Kennen to be a little bit more dominant in these early trades. However, MMD keeping up so far.
Yeah, it was actually really good by MMD. He got a pin with the heroic charge into the wall, so he ate double damage to the heroic charge, and then he ate the Q, both ends of it on Vizachachi, so that's a ton of damage from the Poppy.
Of course, looking, of course, checking in on the junglers as well. MMD, though, he had to be the center. Tanks a tower shot as well. Flash traded for flash. MMD maybe a little too thirsty for the early kills there.
Yeah, I think that flash was unnecessary. The moment he was never going to be able to flash into auto attack range. It looked like it might even require two auto attacks. So you can understand the excitement for MMD. But trading flashes, given how much lane control he had, if he could have just taken the flash away and had the flash advantage, that would have been pretty big.
They already TP'd back. Vizachachi got up there, and now you can see move. He's already trying to come up to the top side, but nope, they're actually going to make it back off there. All right.
Meanwhile, Karsa's on the bottom side. Nothing going to come from it. Hillisang dangerously close. He's getting picked up by the Tahm Kench there. No unacquired Tay stack going to come through, and he has to burn the flash in the end. So a lot of early action here for the Flash Wolves.
Really excited to see this jungle matchup. To me, these are the two power farmers, the two champions that often rack up a big CS advantage over other junglers. Very rare that both are actually active in a game. And the dueling, you'd have to think if Olaf hits that first axe, he actually wins the duels against Nidalee.
Yeah, and I want to look at it stylistically as well. Karsa as a player is very aggressive, likes to invade and move. He only invades when he thinks he can get camp out of it or get some vision. Not that aggressive jungler that goes for those ganks early right now.
Moves in and unfortunately cost him his ghost in the end. You saw Maple moving up and happy to collapse on him if he didn't just immediately run out of there. But already in the mid lane, Maple with a 5 CS advantage, and you said the early levels needs a few points in W, but now that he has it, looks to be in total control.
And Karsa, he's already invading. He knew that he chunked out move, so he's trying to find him in the jungle and trying to harass him and deny a little bit.
Move uses the smite to secure it in the end, but Karsa, hungry for blood, throws the spear. Who is going to connect? Is he going to follow it up?
He's looking for it.
He's going for it. First blood dropping for Flash Wolves. Karsa, is he going to drop two?
Nope.
Makes it out of the tower range just in time.
Already so much aggression from the Flash Wolves.
And we talked about Orianna to counter roam either to pick up the kill and answer. So the Nidalee's going to get out. Really nice stuff from Karsa, and that sets the pace.
What is Chachi doing? He's way too far forward.
Yeah, here comes Karsa MMD ready to set up any potential action here. The red buff ticking down. Chachi in trouble, does get the stun onto MMD in the end. Spear does go wide, still wants the execute. Not hunted, not going to get the mark. MMD hungry for blood.
Ooh.
Dashes to the creep to make it to safety. Red buff ticks, but Chachi walks out with his life. No TP, however, to return to lane.
And this is just really bad for Unicorns of Love. Top half of the map, they've already had their jungler be a little bit dominated now by Karsa, and then visit Chachi to boot. Oh, wasn't doing well in the early game from the get-go, and now, you know, despite everything, he's actually in an okay spot because he's 10 CS up.
And despite the fact that the Olaf might have the advantage in the dueling if he hits the first act, it's the big disadvantage he has. He doesn't have the ability to pounce over walls, doesn't even take flash, so these invading missions move is kind of feeling like he's forced to go into the enemy jungle. But if he's collapsed on, especially pre-6, doesn't have the mobility in Nidalee, and he'll just give more kills over to the Flash Wolves.
Does in the end on that invade get the Wolf Spirit up, so we'll have a little bit more vision onto Karsa, takes the opportunity after seeing Karsa on the top side, but does, as you said, have to be careful because that first one cost him so much. However, top lane, normally expected to be so favored for Kennen. Yes, he has the massive CS advantage, but MMD consistently bullying him out here for damage, and if that transitions into a kill, it could turn around the lane.
Exactly. Ultimately, it's what does this mean for MMD, because he's not ahead in gold. He's actually not even ahead in experience right now over Visichachi. Has nothing really going for himself, despite the pressure that he's had. It hasn't made anything of it.
Of course, now checking in on the bottom lane. Approaching level 6 for Veritas. Hillisang a little bit behind after an early back. Sword Art potentially overstaying his welcome. Ghost comes in from move. The low cooldown, an absolute boom. But Sword Art has the thick skin. Isn't going to have to pop it. We'll get the healing instead.
Just a bit of, nice bit of damage there. No need for Sword Art to use either of his summoners. So can recall, also has a potion to pot. So he's going to be okay in that scenario. So a real big gain for the Unicorns of Love. A little bit of lane control on bot.
So far, a very even early game, despite the kill going over to Nidalee. Interestingly enough, the CS lead maintained for Maple, but not growing. Caitlyn and Ashe going back and forth in the CS department as well. So really waiting for a major breakpoint here from either team. Bot lane appears to be taking control, but Poppy also pushing in on the top side, and pressure feels relatively even.
Right now, Karsa, he knows that the blue buff came up once again.
Exile moving forward. Waiting, maybe gonna look for the steal here. Smite does come out. Spear.
Went over to Exile, he got it.
So close in that exchange. Absolutely crucial for Orianna to get this in the early game, as Vel'Koz known for some of those terrifying early base damages, the potential for the passive there. And Exile still gonna be able to clear these waves, still gonna be able to keep up, at least for now.
Yeah, without the blue buff, you would have to think the double W would just, there'd be no way for Exile to match the wave pressure. So very important the blue buff transfer goes on. Both sides clearly knew that. With Casa moving up, and speaking of moving up,
Triangle looking for it. Axe does connect. The chain slow is ready and available. Maple has the flash. Are they going to keep going? Karsa ready for the turnaround. Unicorns of Love have to back off.
But right now, what do they end up doing with this on Unicorns of Love's side? Now they have an inside track onto the enemy blue buff. They know that it's up. They know that Vel'Koz took a lot of damage. Are they going to try to make something of this? Is the question.
Sword Art taking a cheeky opportunity to lay down the ward. Potentially risky, but takes the chance. It's going to have a little bit more vision, a little bit more information. We'll know now if Unicorns of Love want to push, want to try to contest that blue buff. Instead, it looks like choosing to back off.
Yeah, we always look for that next step, you know, getting the maximum out of just chunking out an opponent, not expecting a lot of lane pressure for even a blue buff Vel'Koz without any summoners. He actually has to get into pretty close range to the minion wave to be able to clear it, theoretically, close to the command attack shockwave range. So expect Maple to have to be super defensive until he has any summoners back up.
Something that I expect to happen in the near future here is Hillisang, once he hits 6, going mid, there's a no summoner spells for that Vel'Koz. It would be an easy pickoff for the way that he's been playing Bard today. Just throw out the Tempered Fate, hit him with the ultimate, and have the follow-up.
There's so much to respect in terms of CC on the side of Unicorns of Love. You think of team fights, sure the Tahm Kench can negate an attack onto one of Ashe or Vel'Koz, but they're both pretty similarly going to be rooted in position during team fights when they're trying to put out damage, and Tahm can only choose one. So target selection, both for the Tahm Kench and then obviously for the Unicorns of Love in team fights, is going to be really interesting to track.
Sword Art taking a bit of poke, but you know, you just got to think about the potential for mobility here. You have the Magical Journey, you have the Abyssal Voyage, both teams the potential to move around the map very quickly to make strong, you know, map-based plays, but also, as you said, the potential to start fights on their terms, the Ash Arrow, the Tempered Fate, Kennen even with the potential for TPs, and it's the same story for Poppy as well.
Watching Hillisang go for a walk.
You just gotta wait. Every time, you can never be sure when that Tempered Fate is going to come out. Looks like he's going to hold on to it for now, but Exile is here. Maybe the potential to go in. They go through the journey, looks at, gets the cat. Ooh, just so good on the Shockwave there. And Sword Art could be down. Looks like they are going to back off in the end. Caitlyn Alti not gonna follow up.
Yeah, no flash there as well from Double Red. It looks like they weren't expecting that, and they got swept out, and then immediately comes through, and maybe they weren't expecting the Orianna on top of it.
Yeah, the Double Red's job this game is going to be very different to the one in the previous game. He had an Aurelion Soul that could go into a side lane. Remember, this time, it is the Vel'Koz who's going to want to stay in mid, pick up blue buff, be behind the turret. It's not just going to be Hurricane Ash predictably wave clearing, getting into the late game easily. He's going to have to be a bit more on his toes and already caught out with both summoners.
Definitely a solid trade in favor of the Unicorns of Love. Not a massive gold lead, but they're happy to now have the edge on the bottom side of the map, and Exile especially may just be stuck in a battle of wave clear when it comes to facing his lane opponent, but already making a larger impact when it comes to moving across the map.
Nice trades of Visicharchi. This lane's going to be pretty similar to Jace vs. Poppy that, of course, people are going to be a bit more familiar with since we saw it throughout the World Championships, especially. I feel like Kennen's going to fall off in terms of having turret threat compared to the Jace a little bit early, but the team fight, that's where Kennen is much more powerful than Jace, so both of them going to be very strong primary initiators, both top laners.
Yeah, difference is Jace's teleports, you know, not as effective as both of these top laners' teleports, so the Poppy is also very effective and can go to other places, but you can see the MMDs falling quite a bit behind in CS currently, but it is being made up by Maple in the mid lane, who has been having a rather good time despite the attention. He's already at the 10 per minute mark in terms of CS on this Vel'Koz, so he's been farming up a storm, and he's just looking to scale a bit into this game.
While the farm is good for Maple, a lot of questions remain around the Vel'Koz, yet to have any major impact. Push waves as predicted, but outside of that, nothing really to show for it. Hasn't gone down, hasn't lost anything, but really expecting a lot from this final pick.
Just the why. Why a Vel'Koz in this particular situation? You can understand if he has a big wave clear advantage, it makes sense, but Orianna, you know, wave clear becomes seminal with her eventually. Sure, he can put out a lot of long-range damage, you know, much like a Jhin in team fights, but he's rude at doing so, and there's so many different ways to close the gap on him on the side of Unicorns of Love that we're just waiting for that flashbulb moment to really show us, demonstrate to us why it was the Vel'Koz.
Oh, could be this one right here. A lot of damage. Karsa moving in. Exile not quite marked up, but a triple stack on the passive.
Who the ghost, though?
Yeah, did actually get the summoner spell out of him, and he hasn't had any extra help here, but Maple...
This is interesting pathing choice. Exile potentially caught out here.
Yeah, he does have Olaf, but Nidalee is there too.
Oh, pulls it forward. Maple in trouble. Does not have the flash yet. He's going to drop, and Karsa, spear not going to connect. Move with a nice sidestep to block the mid-laner.
I really like Exile spacing in lane, moving towards the top left side, because Olaf was invading as well, baiting out the Vel'Koz from walking up. One Shockwave later, Olaf's in place. Nice stuff, Unicorns of Love.
But that also makes you feel very safe if you're Maple, because you know your jungler is also on that side. So you're like, okay, this Orianna's playing towards my side where the jungler is. He's going to get killed, and that's what baited him in.
Interesting as well. Unicorns of Love, decent advantage, and we now look to the jungle position. Karsa, standard build path coming out, but some interesting moves coming in from Move in the jungle with his choices here.
Yeah, I love the Righteous Glory. He did it previously on Olaf, and it's just to enable his team to get in, especially Visicharchi and himself. Those both need to get to the back line, the Kennen and the Olaf both. If they can reach that Vel'Koz, that Ash, they pretty much make it so the damage dealers have to focus them, and they're not focusing somebody like your Orianna or Caitlyn.
Yeah, it's not quite like the Shirelia's Olaf back in the day, because you don't have that team-wide utility, but because he always gets in the fight, the slow can be very powerful, and it makes you super, super fast. These trades, we knew they were going to go towards MMD, and look at this.
Oh, looks like he's going to get the set up the Q, going down. Chachi running for his life. The flash available. Goes in, gets the wall bang, knocks him down.
It just doesn't get much better from here for the Kennen. So, bit of a worry now for Unicorns of Love and top. Karsa never takes an opportunity to miss the turret dive.
Want to keep the ball rolling. Kaelasang caught out and lasered down. Quick staring contest from the Vel'Koz. He comes out on top. Karsa moving forward. Doesn't connect the spear. Baratos now set to fall. He's going to get taken down. Move is in the wrong place at the wrong time. Not going to get anything in the end.
And they just took advantage of the gaps of vision in UOL's jungle. You can see Flash Wolves own this bottom side of the jungle. They own the way to the dragon, and they own the way to the bottom side, and they just owned Unicorns of Love.
Just these coupling the advantages, you know, taking stock of the fact they got a solo kill on top and made the superior rotation in bot, and suddenly it all starts to fall apart on some level for the Unicorns of Love. It's also going to be the soloing of the Cloud Drake for Flash Wolves.
End of the day, it's not the Vel'Koz setting the pace here, but the Nidalee moving in to help make these plays happen. Maple with some nice positioning on the back half of that fight, and Flash Wolves very clearly in control as their bottom lane moves on to the top side of the map.
Now suddenly, you can just park the duo lane against the cannon, negate the ranged versus melee advantage the cannon had had, and things look pretty comfortable for Flash Wolves.
Exactly where they want to be, a small CS lead for Ashe, mid lane relatively even now. Mikasa with a decent lead. Righteous Glory for move, not a purchase that has been able to use yet. Illisang potentially in trouble. MMD just going for a bit of poke there.
Say a bit of poke, looked like a pretty solid chunk to me.
Just gonna half health him, a little bit of poke, a little bit. Just 50%.
Rotating to top actually does help out. That I talked about the awkward period where both Velkoz and Hurricane Ashe are going to want to be in the mid lane. Rotating to top, again, we're delaying that part where they will have to assign one of Velkoz and Ashe to a side lane where they're going to be very easy to be preyed upon.
Now Unicorns of Love, not quite sure what their intention is here. May look for the dive on MMD, instead just auto-attacking the tower. Hillisang taking as many shots as possible, seemingly determined to get back some of the structural gold and even up the difference between them, but it's just going to be the one-for-one trade in the end.
Yeah, but can you continue to push down? This cannon is much squishier than that Poppy and easier to rip through. So if they can actually reach him, Double Red has the arrow.
Flash available. Chachi, sidestep. No, still connects. Chachi potentially in trouble, leaping forward, uses the protobelt to get to safety. Volley going to connect, but no follow-up here. Maple looking for the solo kill, not going to get it. Exile turns it on him.
G Fuel MVP, baby. Exile in the mid lane.
It's just such an impressive showing for a guy, rookie in the summer split, comes internationally, still in his comfort zone, has played super, super well, and vindicating the early MVP award to him.
And this is the question mark, of course, what the Vel'Koz provides, and clearly it is not the 1v1 potential in that circumstance. Orianna's damage instantaneous. Vel'Koz wants to channel that laser. It's just a little too easy for Exile, but it still costs him a ton of life, and Flash Wolves are here to capitalize.
Yeah, great rotation there, using the Abyssal Voyage to get there rather quickly, but Exile just has so much in terms of the wave clear department.
Of course, Flash Wolves backing off in the end, do get down a decent amount of damage. Unicorns of Love behind by a little less than 2K at this stage in the game. A little more, rather. You can take a look at it one more time.
Oh, that was absolutely monstrous. Exile pretty much 100-0s him there, and Exile only took about 20% of his own HP.
I mean, this matchup is really intricate because both champions have to move up to either position the ball or go for the W, and it's all about respecting the different variables available. If the Vel'Koz is ahead, he just walks up in the lane whenever the Orianna starts to move forward to move the ball, hit an E, and then you go for a combo of your own. But it's Exile playing with his tail up. He's in form. He's had a great tournament so far, and he's the one holding down Maple, someone who ran rampant in our last series.
Unicorns of Love now pushing down the mid lane. The itemization tells the same story as you do, Papa Smithy. Needlessly large rod coming in for Exile. Negatron Cloak coming in for Maple on the opposite side.
Yeah, likely to be a death cap. Luden's Echo, obviously an outside opportunity there with the build path that's currently been taken. Rylai's also a possibility as we've returned to Pawsville.
Well, as long as we're here.
Yeah, it might be the Rylai's. I've seen it before from Exile specifically, I believe, earlier in the
Swiffer
tournament.
Was doing it as well.
Yeah, it's actually a fantastic item in order for these guys to actually catch up to things like Ashe, Vel'Koz. You hit him once, he's slowed, everybody's going to catch up to him, right? I mean, also, the Negatron Cloak is a little strange because Abyssal Scepter would be what
with
you would,
ranges,
would turn
right?
into, right? Vel'Koz's effective range, or the way he likes to play from, is way shorter than that range. I believe they're pretty damn
yeah,
small.
I mean, while it's very likely that people will be on top of you as Vel'Koz, it feels like you've already lost the fight at that point. So defensive itemization, maybe just to survive here, but Abyssal, definitely not playing for the ideal scenario, rather the one that he's in currently.
I mean, you're comparing it to a champion like Lux, right? Where Lux will just often go for things like Medjos, things for full AP builds, and it's basically, well, I have 1,000 range on my abilities. If someone gets closer, I'm dead anyway.
Yeah, exactly. And it's a double AP composition. I don't blame him for doing it at all, because the Kennen, if he does get to you, well, if I have the Necrotron Cloak, I have a chance to survive. If I don't, then I'm definitely dead.
Moving forward, Chachi caught out on the bottom side. Karsa is here to punish. Potentially overextending, tanks the spear on the way out. Not at all what he wanted. The chain CC coming in, looking for a kill back, not going to get it. Primal Surge more than enough to heal the wounds.
Really nice stuff there. This Poppy has been at arm's length ahead of Visichachi earlier than expected, earlier than the Poppy versus Jace matchup we frequently see. Been able to itemize very easily into the magic resist, but can even go to Sunfire Cape, which lets you know how comfortable the Poppy feels. They can go to Sunfire Cape against double AP.
Move, throwing down a little bit of poke. We'll pick up the axe, rethrow, gonna miss on the reconnect. However,
Ooh,
using
really
the ghost.
Committing on it.
Double red, has the arrow up and available. They're not going to have to use it in the end. And Chachi, despite the massive CS lead, you know, just even on gold because of the chain ganks that have come down, and it really feels like he's maybe getting over-aggressive here.
It's been the level of being able to actually take advantage of those ganks. When Karsa has visited lanes, they've been able to pick up kills. Otherwise, been farming. Still is 43 CS ahead of another power farmer in Olaf and had more kill involvements, which lets you know that Karsa's just ahead of move straight up.
Oh no, Karsa may have bit off more than he can chew. Unicorns of Love waiting in the bush. Set up from the bar, not quite going to connect.
Optimistic.
Let's back off. Do get the flash from Karsa in the end, as well as secure control over the brush there. But not much going to come of that gank.
And now it's just all about getting that vision control for your next move. Mid lane turret's going to be one that's quite hard to knock down because both of these wave clear mids can play from a very long range. You'd have to dive them. So you're waiting for somebody like MMD to actually get enough armor when he was building magic resistance early to actually go for a dive, or have the Tahm Kench help out. Whereas if you look at the other side, UOL, their Olaf isn't ready to dive at all. He has the Righteous Glory, but he needs a little bit more armor before he can actually go after those turrets.
You can see what the plan is for New Clones of Love. Ash and Tahm Kench rotate. They want to take this mid turret. They're looking to dive it potentially as well. Turret's starting to fall low. It's about 30% HP.
Veritas doing what he can to clear. As he's farming, dodges the arrow. Double red, maybe a little over-aggressive on the placement. Oh. Move wants to get frisky, moving forward.
Have to be a turret dive.
No options for coming in. Double red taking the damage anyway. A little bit late on the swallow from Tahm Kench.
And now they're going to have to try to siege here. Veritas, if he sets up traps, three ranks in it currently, ended up going for the Peacemaker Max first. And this is going to be a difficult siege. Both these compositions actually play pretty well from a siege position.
There is a ward for the Poppy to come in from the backside. It's going to do that.
There he goes.
Here comes the flank. They want the tower anyway. Unicorns of Love are going to stick to it, but how are they going to get out of this scenario? Exile trying to run his way out. Hillisang in trouble. Spear not going to connect. Chachi low health, but no one there to follow up.
Chachi has ult still.
Both teams backing off. Maple not seeing the setup for the ult, and Unicorns Love come out on top.
Yeah, Flash Wall's first instant to go in, of course, looking for the pop, and then they realize, oh crap, we don't actually have that outer turret. Flash cannon, there's no ability to kite back like there was before. So both teams go out. Flash Wall still want to answer with the mid lane turret, though. Cannon's back, but still going to be difficult to outpush this Orianna.
Maple looking for the angle to throw down a bit of Halas. Going to have to recall all the days. Geometry, but not going to find it today. Karsa picking up the blue buff for himself as he takes it away from the Unicorns of Love. That will be relatively major in the coming moments. And possibly you said Luden's Echo, a rare chance. Looks like it might be what Exile's going for, or do you think we're just getting the Aether Wisp for the extra mobility?
I think almost certainly it has to be the Luden's Echo because you have the two constituent parts there. There's always the outside chance, something crazy, but for now, we will call it the Luden's. I don't think it's going to be Lich Bane onto the Orianna.
Yeah, it's
I'm sure it's been done before.
That's the thing, it's Unicorns of Love, right? You can't be confident. You want to say never, but you don't know for sure. That
I mean, it's Flash Wall's throwing the curveballs. We have a last pick Velkos to consider here.
And the Siege coming out is pretty impressive. Decent defensive tools with the Tahm Kench on the backside, but they can only save one person. For now, it is double red, but that tower almost entirely taken down, and Maple throwing down a large amount of damage. Move in the meantime, though, takes the Mountain Drake.
Double red has actually been doing wonders for Flash Wolves. He's actually been quite good substitution here. Doing great work. He's up in CS. He's synergizing quite well with Sword Art. They're in a lane where they have a range disadvantage, and also it's not even a range support on his side. He has the Tahm Kench, and yet they've been able to set things up constantly.
And the teamfight phase is going to be super interesting, considering the positioning of first the Velkos, then the Ashe. They can't be next to each other, then they're going to eat the AoE CC, whether it's from the Bard, the Orianna, or the Cannon. They also have to synergize really well with their support. So positioning for Ashe, even with Tahm Kench, where you think, okay, I've got an out, not necessarily, given just how many options Unicorns of Love have.
Oh, Karsa caught out. There's a lot of damage. Chachi picking up the kill in the end, but look at the proactive play from Exile.
Roaming up towards this Baron, there is some vision here. It's worth noting for the Flash Wolves. They certainly know this has been started. Scrying Orb as well.
Coming and killing it pretty quickly. They have a lot of damage threats. Poppy on the way, Vel'Koz on the way, double red over the wall. The arrow is up and available. Unicorns of Love walk away with the Baron 23 minutes in.
A beautiful call there as well. They pick off Karsa. They don't have to use much for it at all. And they take down the Baron, and now they're rotating top, instantly going to cash in.
And this is sort of thing in a VOD where you can pause and say, okay, Karsa needed to flash because he knew his Poppy didn't have teleport. He was just surprised by the damage. He had some magic. When he went down, Poppy's completely out of position, and credit to Unicorns of Love making the proactive call, the sort of things that Flash Wolves and other teams of this tournament like Longju have struggled to do, and now suddenly the game blown open for the Unicorns of Love.
The power of Baron evening up to gold, the tower giving them a slight lead. Unicorns of Love in the driver's seat.
Yeah, I actually do want to touch on that, because Karsa was out and still there with 2,000 gold. When he died, he purchased from an Amp Tome straight to Athene's Unholy Grail.
So he didn't even have that magic resist.
Exactly. He's like, oh my god, I need magic resist now, because that just happened to me. But you shouldn't be out with that much gold when you can't afford that item. Maybe he was clearing Raptors for that last little bit, but that's still really greedy to be sitting on that much.
And while Karsa and Maple are taking some defensive measures, not the same case for Double Red, and he may need to, because look at the amount of raw AP being picked up by Exile. Doesn't even need pen items, just going straight for that death count.
And Unicorns of Love are going for the bulldoze approach.
Wants to get in there. Vel'Koz over the wall is doing a lot of damage. Hillisang not going to get the kill. Ooh, Shockwave not connecting. Almost disaster there for Flash Wolves, but they're holding on for now.
Yeah, Unicorns of Love not making the percentage play. They're not bringing out minion waves. They want to dive.
Connects with Maple.
Just get damage on tower.
Taking the tower in the end. Vel'Koz getting a little frisky. MFD goes in again. Chachi going to get cut down. Sword Art gets aggressive on the front side, but they will not pick him up. Karsa looking for a way into the back line. Leaps forward. Not going to get anyone. Flash out to safety. Now Move has to ghost. Has to try to find a way out, but MFD is fearless. He's going to get the double stun. Doesn't look like there's any follow-up. We'll keep your eyes on the Ori.
Double Red almost has his ultimate. It's about to come up. It's off right now.
Ash Arrow up available. Hillisang, are you playing too far forward? They're ready to moment's notice to turn this one back. Flash Wolves back in control of the game, have a decent lead now. They do not care about the Baron buff. They're barreling down for the tier 2. Chachi going to fall. The shield comes in. Yes, they do get the kill in the end, but it's so close to getting away. Exile, not quite enough for shields.
Yeah, Exile will have the Orianna ultimate available in about 5 seconds. That's why Move persisting.
Ragnarok, there's no tools to stop him from moving into the backline, but he's going to back off of his own volition. Exile hungry for blood. He wants a little bit more. He's getting so much damage
his
down.
Almost up.
Not going to be enough. Karsa moving forward. Baratos, can he stop Karsa from getting in? No! Oh. The shockwave, the misplay. It doesn't matter. The damage is too much, and Karsa gets popped.
Ash is completely out of position. Double Red backings, taking his time, also out of position. Is another member. Wow,
Chachi, that's a lot of damage. But I don't think it's going to be enough. Pop goes Maple. Unicorns of Love pushing up mid.
Yeah, they still have the Baron buff as well for a little bit longer here. It's about 3/4 of the way done. So that's going to be enough to push up, get it, this turret. And they only have an Ash and also a Tahm Kench to defend. They have to play this safe on Flash Wolf side or else they'll lose even more.
I mean, Flash Wolves overstay. They weren't realistically going to get that inner turret. Doesn't matter if you get a kill on Hillisang, it's just the support. And they're going to pay a pretty hefty penalty in their first inhibitor of the game.
And there's even a gigantic wave on the bottom side, and it looks like it's being prepped right now, and the vision from Hillisang is also coming out on that side, so he's prepping it. They'll back, possibly, or they'll just continue to shove. There are about 5 seconds left on Maple here.
You just keep thinking about the Vel'Koz last pick. Remember, last pick, they had full information of the 5 picks, and if this was a game 3 where Flash Wolves were 2-0 up, what would you call this? It'd be just like when we saw the Fiora lock in from Smeb. You're like, oh, this is a confidence pick. He's styling a little bit. This is the first game of a best of 5, and he made the measured choice of the Vel'Koz, and it really hasn't been the game breaker it intended to be.
I'd call it a bit of a mistake as well, because then you have 3 losing lanes.
True.
And especially when it doesn't go your way.
Oh,
this
I
right
just
here.
Love Exile. So aggressive, yeah. Looking for whatever he can.
2 seconds from his ultimate being off cooldown, it finally comes off. Doesn't end up hitting Karsa with that, but Veritas had his back.
A perfect play in the end there. Anticipates that Nidalee is going to make it in. Veritas says, no, I got you with the trap. So at the end, the ult does not connect, but still makes it out with some confidence. Chachi, of course, just the last moment of styling.
Yeah, Double Red and Maple completely out of position. One recall goes through, but of course, they need both Wave Clear members full health for their inhibitor turret not to go down. Unicorns of Love turning this around. Remember, this was Flash Wolves' game not 15 minutes ago.
Yeah, and then a very bold call from UOL to take the drag or the Baron at 23 minutes when they had caught Karsa out. Now the Baron is gone, but they just get to keep sieging out.
Oh,
Exile.
Exile's caught. The Bardock goes in, cancels the Vel'Koz. Hillisang gets the stun for follow-up. The Poppy TP is canceled, but she continues to push on the top side and is breaking down towers.
It's only an inner turret. There's no more than that. They will have to take significantly more penalty here. Still do have Flash available for Chachi, but not enough health. So for now, Inatar would actually stay up.
Yeah, Exile's going to have to actually back and go towards that top side. He is already 2 levels up over Maple, and he's going to get even more experience off of this. But I'll probably give over this Drake to UOL, despite the fact that Poppy, you know, no teleport, no way to join this. So it's a pretty confident move here.
Yeah, it's just going to be a answering Cloud Drake. It's just going to ensure that there are no little advantages when it comes to the engage. Coming through it later in the game.
And surprisingly, the gold is just about dead even. 300 just does not matter at this stage of the game. The Cloud Drake and the Mountain. Just the Mountain in favor of Unicorns of Love, as Flash Wolves have a cloud of their own. But the Inhibitor, maybe the bigger concern for Flash Wolves this stage.
Oh, absolutely. They have to be able to defend that, and it's just constant wave pressure. And these two outer turrets that are remaining, and two, I guess, inner turrets, as we like to call them, tier twos. Which one does Unicorn want to play towards right now? Because the Drake just went down. You play towards the bottom side, you can possibly open up more options for you in the future on the Baron, or you play for the top side one, the harder one, or the one to get right now, but then it means that if you do end up in a situation where you're 4-1 split pushing in the Baron, you can get a tier 2 on the bottom side with your split pusher much easier.
Yeah, it's good to see Unicorns of Love playing three lanes. They have so much pressure mid.
No Sank. Perfect portal. Get stunned as he's already starting the animation. It is going to make it out in the end. Very close scenario there. Hillsang very forward for the entirety of this game.
Touches no teleport, neither does MMD. They're trying to move Vision forward with Baron spawning in 40 seconds.
Of course,
Exile's so monstrously strong at this point. Extra needlessly large rod on top of the Ludens, Morella Nomicon, and the Void Staff. Style choice though, no death cap. The extra movement speed from Ludens, slight bit of burst, sure, but no death cap. Basically means the shields are lower, but with 10% extra move speed, he's looking to sidestep the Ash Eyes, looking to sidestep some of the Velko's CC. Otherwise, you'd see death cap 9 times out of 10.
Yeah, absolutely. You thought it was going to be a death cap there. He had all the components to make it.
Clearly.
But I guess he sees that the Poppy is getting a little bit tankier and that there's also some magic just coming in. So being able to shred through it, this also helped him kill double red in one combo.
Definitely exactly where they want to be. Baron now up and available 30 minutes into the game, 7-7 in kills, 52 to 52K, almost dead even. Big breakpoint will be the next fight. An Inhibitor down in favor of the Unicorns of Love, but Flash Wolves were in control for this game for so long. The Vel'Koz remains the question mark.
Wave clear for now. The Baron buff, the big objective on the map. You have to think. The driver's seat is Unicorns of Love, having that Inhibitor down. For now, Kossa feels confident enough to walk up to his creeps, his monsters, sorry, and clear them. So pressure hasn't quite been there from Unicorns of Love after their very decisive first Baron take.
UOL pushing in, flashes up and available for every member of every team. Cooldowns all available. The next fight will be explosive. No one has a massive advantage, but Unicorns of Love are looking to build one with Vision as they start to clear out here.
Oh, that's also the Smite as well coming out from move. So Flash Wolves know he won't have it for about 15 seconds. That's one charge down. But also, the Smite fight would be really risky because Karsa's level 16. He's 2 levels up over move. It's always a little bit riskier when he's got 2 levels.
And additionally, paired with the Execution in the cat form, the takedown, a lot of potential burst damage onto the Baron. Unicorns of Love not as confident in pulling the trigger here without Karsa off the table.
Yeah, it kind of seems like they're trying to bait back and forth, trying to catch somebody. The middle Inhibitor has respawned, and that might be where they would try to push next, but MMD is doing a really good job of applying pressure to the bottom side. He keeps pulling Visichachi away, so they can't find a lot of those little peaks.
So the correct play here for Unicorns of Love is a couple of people invading the red side and setting up flank wards for the Kennen. They're going to put down a pink ward, they're going to start Baron, and if Kennen comes from the backside, there really isn't much of an answer for Flash Wolves to a Kennen engage. So for now, you look and you see with the double pinks down, there are no Kennen flank wards around Baron, and that means that Unicorns of Love can't really advance the game any further, and that just leads to this stall right now as both teams kind of reassess and look for that all-important initiation.
Yeah, and it's going to even take longer for you all because they just had all of their vision cleared out of the Baron pit. They're pretty much taking stock of everything, clearing out the jungle, getting Veritas, that red buff, as well as Exile, the blue buff, and backing, buying, making sure that they're all ready for this one moment where they can ward up the Baron and start pushing from there and try to get that vision that you're talking about.
Move, locking down what vision he can in the meantime, but of course, as you guys mentioned, both teams just waiting for a mistake, looking for an opportunity, playing out the game. It's formulaic for them. They've been here. This is the Baron bait. This is the Baron dance we know so well. Neither one going to give up any major opportunities yet, but someone's going to slip up eventually. Someone's going to go to clear a ward that they shouldn't clear. Someone's going to overstep or overpush or use their TP in the wrong place, and at that moment, the other team can just explode into the lead.
Yeah, it's been a really interesting one to track. It felt like Flash Wolves, you know, the Nidalee was getting ahead, the Roams were coming off, move was second to every engage, like, okay, Flash Wolves, they're parlaying what they did in the previous series into this one, but Unicorns of Love steadied, and specifically the carries here, Maple and Double and Double Red on champions that are very punishing if you're out of position. I've been caught out of position a couple of times, cast a court around the Baron that led to the start of Unicorns of Love's advantage, and now it's all up in the air. So we're just waiting for there to be the wards to allow the flanks, to allow the initiation, because Double Red, he's not looking for picks. Basically, Flash Wars are kind of licking their wounds at this point, and Unicorns of Love, they're the ones that are begging, they're just trying to find, they want to force a fight, but only really Baron is going to get a fight out of Flash Wars.
Absolutely. They'll be able to defend. They're keep putting MMD in a side lane to split push, so you have to kind of bait the Baron, possibly bait a teleport, or also get your own teleport in a really good spot, and they just haven't been able to get those wards just yet, because that requires you pushing up. It doesn't seem like Unicorns of Love are really selling like Doran's Blades on Vizachachi or anything for pink wards, or making sure that they're backing and having their inventory stocked with them just yet, because they don't have any on the ground, and they also don't have any in their inventories, except for one from Hillisang.
And the one thing you can say for Flash Wars, look at some of these CS numbers. They actually have advantage in every member except for the mid lane. The mid lane's about 30 down, but they have an advantage on the Poppy because Poppy's just been sitting in a side lane, whereas Kennen has been grouping. Big advantage in the jungle, expected after the advantage that Nidalee had. But also, even Double Red, he's picked up 45 more CS than a Caitlyn and one of the most safe wave clearers. So the scores are even, but so much of the gold and the slight gold lead here is because Flash Wars have kept up their CS farming throughout this game.
Yeah, down one turret, but they still have all of that farm. And it was almost MMD. He used to be behind Vizachachi in farm, if I remember correctly. The Kennen had an edge over that Poppy for so long, and then eventually, because of the split push and the nature of the Poppy-Kennen matchup, then he actually takes control of it and just starts having a split push advantage with the Sheen and with the fact that he clears the waves pretty quickly.
I mean, the cost of going for these wards, looking for those Kennen wards, is that you're grouping and the Poppy's just chilling, taking free turret waves, free minion waves in the bot side. But if you don't get the wards, then you just gave away 40 CS to your opponent. You just gave away minions. Literally, this is just a case that minions are dying to turrets or just dying to minions on the side of the map that Unicorns Love just aren't able to claim because they're tunneled on getting vision to start a fight, but they're not getting it. So in essence, they're just giving over free resources to Flash Wars.
Of course, still waiting on a fix here for Karsa. Should be taken care of soon. In the meantime, however, have to wonder who's going to make the first misstep. We talked about it earlier. And really, what the opportunities are to do so. Because it seems like, honestly, MMD and Vizachachi, the two split pushers, have just not been making any mistakes for aggression outside of the few missteps from Vizachachi in the early game.
It's really kind of been Hillisang that's been walking forward and trying to make those aggressive plays. Sometimes he's getting a little bit caught out, but he's also catching other people out, and he's just putting himself at risk. Otherwise, there haven't been too many risks taken by either side, even to this point. I do want to touch on something with the pauses, though, because you have to be able to keep yourself sharp. You have to keep track of the game and the pauses. Even if it lasts like 2 minutes, you walk away, come back, you still have to remember the state of the game, what you were intending to do, what you want to do next, and how you're trying to play this out, and not get frustrated either. The focus is so important when these types of moments happen. To just jump right back on the railroad track and keep going, that's very difficult to do, and it may throw somebody off.
Of course, game one as well. Have to stay strong. It is going to be not just a battle of, you know, each and every one of these games, a battle of mental fortitude as we push into potentially a longer series, as these guys do seem to have a lot of parity. Very close in the gold line. Very close coming out of the mid game, but Karsa.
Trap.
Potentially caught again. No CC going to go down for follow-up. That could have been the Baron for Unicorns of Love, or maybe a big fight, but Karsa makes it out with his life. Cooldowns traded back and forth.
There's a lot of rhetoric for Karsa.
Oh. Hillisang in trouble. Hillisang potentially the one to get caught out. The chance CC comes in. Will he be able to make it through the portal? He is healed up as well. Veritas on the lookout for his team, but that's summoner spells now in favor of Flash Wolves.
Until the blood pressure is starting to rise for both these teams, it's actually Flash Wolves are the ones that are looking for that important pick. Even onto Hillisang, taking him out, being able to clear all the vision around Baron would be massive. Inches away from doing so, but not quite yet.
And you talk about summoner spell advantage. It's that teleport. Vizachachi no longer has that. He's going to have to start grouping with the team, possibly making a fight start, and that's what he's looking for here.
Now the pressure is on Unicorns of Love to make the proactive play. Flash Wolves get the luxury of reacting to whatever they do. The teleport gives them the freedom to be responsive, to put MMD on the bottom side, just to let them push and to steadily build advantage. Chachi, in the meantime, has to play safe, has to be careful here.
Sheen in the inventory, so a bit of damage towards turrets available for MMD. Not quite the Iceborne Gauntlet yet that we're heavily predicting to come in, but cannot leave too much free time for the Poppy take a inner turret. Will be the first turret falling in a while just because otherwise basically been a stalemate around Baron.
Second Cloud Drake now coming in for the Unicorns of Love. Elder Dragon will be on the table in about 6 minutes, so the split for objectives potential is there, although Unicorns of Love will struggle to take down that dragon. Double Cloud, of course, not the biggest buff to have, but the extra movement speed will be welcome on the team, especially as long as Chachi has that TP down.
Yeah, the person I'm looking at on Unicorns of Love to actually put into place what we've been musing about, those aggressive wards, has to be Move. He's the one who has the Ragnarok. Ghost is on a very low cooldown, be available about 45 seconds. It should be the likes of Hillisang and Move moving as a unit into the red side jungle to actually put down a couple of those wards and facilitate some sort of deep vision. There is a pink in that Raptor Brush, but that's all there is. There should be some spots here, some creative wards that could allow Kennen to come from the back.
Exactly. They're the ones that have wards. They're the ones that have the sweepers, and they also have the ability to get away, put Magical Journey down, things like that. And we've been talking about two-man units in jungle support synergy. People have been talking about how you need three people to invade now. You need four people to move as an entire group to actually get that vision down. But they haven't been going for that just yet. And it looks like Double Red.
Double Red connects onto Exile. No tools left to save him alive. He is going to flash to safety, though. Small advantage to flash rolls. They force him out. But MMD is in the middle. Veritas is in trouble. Ald is going to connect for Bard, but it is not enough. Knocked up, move set to be knocked out. Unicorns of Love losing control in the middle lane, Chachi. Spear is not going to connect. Flashful is backing off, headed straight for the Baron.
Really big engage by MMD over the Raptor pit, not spotted whatsoever. One wave cleared down, the other one DPS'd out. The Smite DPS'd out. This should be Baron to Flashful.
Exactly what you were talking about. Got to have those flank wards. The TP comes through from MMD, and Flashfuls might get the Baron right here.
Ticking down lower and lower. Yes, Karsa is going to take it away. Hillisang and Chachi, have they overstepped? In comes the Abyssal Voyage. They are not welcome here. Stun not going to connect. MMD Sword Art running in. At the end of the day, Spear does connect. Chachi potentially in trouble. MMD wants more. Hillisang gets the double stun over the wall. Exile looking for a play. Only going to connect one. Doesn't want it on the Tahm Kench. Double Red is going to back off. Unicorns of Love falling behind here as Flashfuls now control the pace of the game. Oh, in comes the alt. Exile barely making that in time.
Seemed like Unicorns of Love had the inside track to accelerating the game, to finishing out with a Baron, but it was the creative play by MMD and the lack of defensive vision, because they've been so in the mindset of needing to put down offensive vision. Great punish from MMD. We didn't even think he'd be playing at this tunnel. We thought, okay, they've included Rinse. He's going to be starting to learn a bit more. We're learning more about MMD, and so far, so good.
Yeah, he's been looking great. Even his laning phase was pretty damn good considering the matchup, but he wasn't CSing exactly as well as you would like, but otherwise he's been pretty damn good.
And look, he turned a Sheen into a Trinity Force. Now he's going to have serious damage both in the team fights and crucially in the split push. And although right now Visichachi has that teleport advantage, if that ever changes, he's going to rip through turrets on his own.
A massive threat to the back line now. And they don't have the luxury of Peel on the side of Unicorns of Love. So much potential for engage. But if someone gets on top of Exile and Veritas, not a whole ton of tools for those individuals to protect themselves. So they have to respect MMD. And MMD being the playmaker that Flash Wolves need, helping them in this late game decision-making moments by finding those clutch engages.
Exactly, those make or break moments. If he's able to get to Veritas again, Veritas has purchased a QSS, so there is a possibility that he can kind of slip away from it now, but still, it's so much damage from the Poppy with the Trinity Force, and the fact that more items are just coming through for Flash Wolves, and with the fact they have Baron on top of it, looking for those turrets.
Just so punishing for Unicorns of Love that Flash Wolves were able to have their Poppy sit in the side lane, pick up a lot of CS, get item advantages because of all the CS they got, and then not even pick up the Baron. He'd get punished.
Visichachi is backing right now. There might be a teleport play behind the Flash Wolves here. There's been pings onto the ward that is over the wall. He is waiting for the home guard. Are they going to go for it?
His team's just not in position. I mean, the Caitlyn certainly won't be there, but neither will the Poppies.
Exile is here now. The Shockwave is up and available. The Tempered Fate ready.
Visichachi has been the captain, the vocal member of the team. He's the one who's been trying to make the plays, and he's got to have to make one here if they want to break it. No, he's going to walk up to the top side. He's wasted too much time inside the base. He's giving up turrets for free.
MMD. There's a grouped minion wave coming in top, so that's why he reacts. He can't afford to wait anymore. There goes an inner turret as well. Flash Wolves, they had the decisiveness, and it's the indecisiveness of Unicorns of Love. Not something that we could really claim from them the rest of this weekend, but now suddenly, in their first final, indecisiveness is really hurting Unicorns.
Hesitation costs them a tier 2 tower. What else will it cost them in the coming plays? As Hillisang does his best to sidestep each and every skill shot. In comes the Abyssal Voyage. It's the Unicorns of Love. They're using it to take down the bottom tier tower. In comes the TP from Kennen. Move is onto the back line. Maple is in trouble. They have no way to CC him down, but he doesn't have the damage to threaten Maple. There is the setup. But is there going to be the follow-up? No, fails to connect the snare. Unicorns of Love need to respect the potential for engage here. Maple still has the ultimate.
Ariana and Kennen both were well out of positions. They didn't have any follow-up CC, so okay, they stopped their tower from going down, but no ball for Unicorns.
Yeah, and they even blow the teleport there from Visichachi.
Veritas so low from the poke, move at half health as well. Things not looking good. No more Baron buff to back them up, but Flash Wolves, a lot of raw power if they want to shoot for a dive here.
Next minion wave will probably be the go time. Veritas did find time to go get the heal up. The health pools will be there, but Flash Wolves, they smell blood.
Exactly, and they've been doing such a great job of sieging this turret. The constant spears coming out from Karsa. And the fact that also the Elder Dragon's almost up. 10 seconds on that one. MMG's gonna charge up the ultimate. Make sure that they get that turret.
Poppycopter zoning off the remaining members of the Unicorns of Love as they lose their first inhibitor tower. Maple, a decent amount of damage going down. Hillisang wants the hero play. Maple caught out. The rest of the team is there. In comes the Shack Wave. It's not going to be enough. Move alone in the back line, but Tom Kench says no. Chachi says yes, though, as they find their first pick. Maple, will he find the setup? No ult available. Hillisang in trouble. Flash Wolves are starting to turn the fight. Unicorns of Love, though, still hungry for more, but the spear sends them back as Veritas must retreat.
And when Kennen ult's down, when Shockwave's down, when Hillisang is there, they don't have any more CC. Easy for Flash Wolves to kite back. They're going to kite back towards an Elder Drake, and it doesn't seem like Unicorns of Love is in any position to contest.
Exactly, they can't contest it. No teleport from Visichachi. That's going to be going over to the Flash Wolves.
Elder Dragon now backing them up as well. They may not have a lot to make that buff impactful, but the extra damage will be welcome as they push forward if they want to break that open inhibitor, because they've already been so proactive in poking down the Unicorns.
Now the Unicorns are doing something unorthodox. They're walking in towards the red. They will be spotted out. That's awkward here for Exile. They knew that was spawning. They're just trying to find something. I imagine it might have been a brush camp. It might have been just following the massive group minion wave in top lane, but not going to be able to have a cheeky brush camp because you have to think the Flash Wolves are onto them at this point.
Yeah, but Karsa is backing and Maple is in the mid lane. Unicorns of Love may be set to break down this tower, but can they afford to take the fight that follows? Looks like not. They are going to back off.
Topsy-turvy game, this one. So far, MMD's been the game breaker. That one engage has really been what separated the two teams, because Unicorns of Love had done some great work before. Exile, close to 100% kill participation. He's played out of his mind, but a couple of those Orianna shockwaves haven't hit as big as they needed to. And even though the score is flawless, the play has not been quite so far.
Have to be careful. At the end of the day, Exile, there's so much pressure on this guy to succeed. You know, he has the major tool that can win a team fight in a moment if he hits it on multiple members, but very difficult for him to do so. The Nidalee, the Vel'Koz, the Ashe, all so comfortable to stay as far away from him as possible and move, unfortunately, lacking the damage. Really threatened the back.
Double red.
Oh, double red misses the ult.
Oh,
he's going to get stunned up.
Punished.
TP coming in. Oh, Tom Kench says no. Chachi wants to go in again, though. Is he going to get the CC? MMD still knocks members out of the fight. This could be advantage for Flash Wolves. Move is just going to cut down. There's nothing there for him, but Chachi moving forward with Exile. The duo solo laners moving in to get more, but Chachi is so low. The stun comes in. Double kill for Exile. Unicorns of Love now moving in mid.
Even with the Elder Dragon, the Unicorns of Love decide to take a fight to Flash Wolves. This is one of the points where Flash Wolves are stronger, but they find a double red out of position. He wasn't thinking that that was what was going to happen to him. That's actually baffling that they decided, boom, that's the moment. They saw it. They saw him out of position, and they took it.
And while 2-for-1 sounds good, because it's moved, they have really no one else to walk up. And with so much poke, there's always the chance that the right spear lands and things turn around from Flash Wolves. So even with the outnumbered, because they have no one else that can catch spears or that can shrug off the damage poke that's coming from Flash Wolves. Unicorns of Love, they find a bit of gold, but nothing else.
Ping's going into the mid lane as the carries are left alone.
They do find themselves a little bit of a teleport advantage, though. 45 seconds on Visichachi's Baron is up currently, whereas MMD, his teleport, really far from being up. So they'll be able to split the Flash Wolves however they want. And remember, there is an exposed inhibitor bot and mid here.
Flash Wolves, of course, in control with position of the Baron Pit, but do not have the tools to clear out the vision of the Unicorns of Love. They will have knowledge of Flash Wolves opt to start. Karsa just going to back off and clear his jungle as Ashe clears on the bottom side. Unicorns of Love now moving in to take control of the pit for
themselves.
They
see Ashe bottom. They might try a Baron. Remember, Tom is right behind Ashe, so he's there to be able to ferry, but this Baron's going to go down quick.
Karsa is here as well.
7K counting down. MMD ready with the flank. Here comes the rest of the team. Tomcat just delivered one in. Are they going to be able to start the fight? Baron's ticking down. Are they going to back up? In goes the ult from Hillisang, but he is low. Will he drop? Chachi and MMD solo fight on the backside. Karsa gets one. Orion is down. Flash Wolves in control of the tempo of the fight. Move trying to make his way out. Flash Wolves ready to cut through the Unicorns. Maple looking for the flank to the side. Backing off in the end for the Unicorns, but that will be the Baron for Flash Wolves.
Unicorns of level one, completely different pages. Hillisang went in for an aggressive use of the Magical Journey into ultimate. No one else was in position and nearly just cleaned up the Orianna in the backline for the second time. Flash Wolves are going to pick up an uncontested Baron.
And right there, UOL, they didn't even get to use a lot of their ultimates in that fight. It just looked like they were in a bad position and completely scattered, like you said. That's even more going over to Flash Wolves. They'll be able to go back to, remember when they were sieging bottom? It was absolutely devastating. They slowly chipped away at the turret. Even with the traps down, they still walk up, get a few shots.
Baratos! Makes it out with his life, but the poke coming in from the Unicorn, or from the Flash Wolves, rather, is absolutely insane. That inhibitor is nothing in the face of the raw power of this team. They're going to break a second one as well. Hillisang stepping forward, but I don't know what he hopes to accomplish here.
Well, they have a flank Olaf here on the double red.
Move on his way in, but he takes so much damage here. There's no follow-up as well. Overstays is welcome.
There's style. So much damage. Pizzachachi walked up, cast a walk away immediately.
And now there's not going to be any freedom of movement for Unicorns. Double inhibitor down. Minion wave going to be coming from the top side as well. Just some crucial communication errors around the Baron have cost them now to the tune of two inhibitors and two Barons. And it feels like Flash Wolves are just one solid push away from ending game one.
Two inhibitors, two Barons, and a 9K gold deficit that they now have to stare down. The 600 gold, the 2,000 gold, the 4,000 gold may not mean much at the 45-minute marks, but that is a lot of difference between them. Death caps on both of the AP threats. Ash at the six-item threshold. This is a terrifying Flash Wolves to behold, and only one inhibitor stands left before they will surely be able to break the base.
Yeah, but now you know exactly where they'll go. And nice dodge from Chachi.
Pulling back in the end. Double red and the rest of Flash Wolves pushing in. Poppy in the mid lane.
Yeah, but also in the bottom lane, you have Exile there. Exile is a big part of these team fights if they want to make it happen. Try to beat Flash Wolves. But Flash Wolves, they've been really good about taking the right fight. Those two Barons didn't happen by accident. Flash Wolves were able to actually punish UOL when they saw him out of position.
Exile doing what he can to clear the waves, as are the rest of the Unicorns. Karsa throwing spears over the wall. The Geometry Strike coming in from Maple. He's trying to land each and every one of those Qs if he can. A lot of potential damage threat coming in. Exile can't comfortably clear the cannon creep. It's the long, slow siege here. The traps keeping the Unicorns safe for now.
And Chachi can go for an engage. He's teleporting in.
All the way in the back. They
Flash
know that he's there.
There's the setup. Three. This could be perfect. Are they going to get in there? They're pulling back. No. In comes the save from Sword Art. Chachi gets exhausted immediately. Unicorns of Love are scattered. MMD disrupts the fight, and Chachi is left alone. Down he goes. Double Red gets the kill. The laser comes out and is immediately canceled. Unicorns of Love now on the back foot. Will the final inhibitor break? Hillisang. Whoa. Almost deleted instantly. Meanwhile, the rest of the team is on the bottom side. The Abyssal Voyage ferries in the Flash Wolves, potentially to their first game win. Unicorns of Love desperately trying to hold on. Karsa gets popped. Orianna is up and available, but it is not enough, and Flash Wolves will take the first game.
Flash Wolves' decision-making around the fights, around the Barons, was one of the only things that separated these two teams. First game of a best of five goes over to the Flash Wolves. And Unicorns of Love, you know, we have a lot of caster rhetoric, whether it's in best of threes or best of fives. There still is a lot of time for Unicorns to come back, but they'll feel kind of robbed here because for long swaths of the 48 minutes, Unicorns had the control.
Yeah, and that's one of the things that the Vel'Koz ends up bringing is it's hard to get in, it's hard to make those decisions, and they have to be snap decisions too. Sure, Unicorns of Love had the control, but you have to make that decisive moment happen because if you don't, Vel'Koz pokes, pokes, pokes over and over again, and then you can't make that actual action happen.
And you saw the sheer amount of damage coming out from him in those last couple plays to poke down each and every member of the Unicorns. But I gotta say, some insane plays coming in from Sword Art on that Abyssal Voyage, and additionally, MMD, the man who kept making those fights happen.
I think Poppy's a problem. I think they have to remove Poppy or pick it for themselves if UOL want to turn it around, but I think it becomes a priority pick for both teams.
I mean, it was most clear in that last fight where MMD could just stand to the whole back line and Kennen was kind of on his own looking for a flank engage. Sure, Orianna could walk through, but nothing else could be done, and it was close. It was a very close margin. It sets us up for what should be a very competitive best of five.
Well, with game one under wraps, we're going to send things back over to the Xfinity analyst desk to break that one down.
Thank you very much, guys. Great cast in that game one, and a very competitive game it was. And let's pop off from the picks and bans. We did see that surprise Vel'Koz coming out, but Freshkering, you especially had your eyes on the Ashe for double red throughout that game.
Double red. So Ashe for the Flash Wolves, I think, is such a fundamental pick simply because it shores up a lot of their discrepancies in the late game. Again, it's about being decisive and making sure that they can close out. And when you have a tool that's so powerful as that enchanted crystal arrow, it just makes it so much easier for them. And time again, it was that arrow connecting on pivotal targets. I mean, we think back to the fact that it nailed Exile right in the face, forced him to burn his Flash back up. And then when MMD came in from the back and got the surprise gank, he didn't have those escapes available to him anymore.
And I really like the combination of the Ashe and the Tahm Kench, because you have the Ashe as your engage tool, and the Tahm Kench was simply used as just walk around and make sure that anybody that gets ultied by a bar that gets Tempered Fate gets eaten right away. So it becomes very difficult, and Flash Wolves just off to a really great start here from Karsa, being able to get basically a solo kill off of reading what move was doing, and he doesn't even die there.
Yeah, I mean, he basically set the Flash Wolves up for success at the very start of the game. It got a little bit shaky as we moved in. Unicorn started making some moves like this, down bottom, picking up that kill onto double red. But Karsa getting rolling on that Nidalee. He was much more reserved this time around, didn't make any, you know, really rash decisions. There was a time he leapt into the trap, but he basically just didn't even see that one. That's what got him killed. So it was a really good job by him to pick up that first blood and just get the ball rolling for Flash Wolves.
And what's cool is that Flash Wolves weren't dependent on Karsa being kind of the, or excuse me, by Maple being the primary playmaker for them. You think back to their Aurelion Soul game, it was so definitive, it looked so much stronger. This time around was on the Vel'Koz, was locked down in that mid lane, including getting that solo kill, or Exile getting that solo kill on him, and it was a left up to the rest of the members to pick up that dead weight.
Yeah, I feel like Maple basically played more of a utility role in this. It was exactly. Just constantly chipping down, poking, you know, his laser beam never really melted like 100 to 0 somebody, but it was always working them down so that they were in a position to contest certain objectives or to, you know, invade for vision. So it was just really smart play by Maple. Didn't die nearly as many times as I kind of expected him to on the Vel'Koz, but overall it was pretty strong play from the Flash Wolves.
Mentally or strategically, what does this mean going further into the best of five? Actually, we'll talk about that in a second. And you guys want to jump in on this one?
Oh, no, this is just the play that I was talking about. The fact that the arrow connects right in Exile's mouth. He burns his Flash, and MMD comes around. It's like, surprise, round two.
Yeah.
Well, mentally, the difficulty with this is that this has been a 50-minute game one, which is really tough for you to go into a best of five knowing that there's a potential of four more games, considering that the Flash Wolves have played today as well as the Unicorns. They're like, Flash Wolves are coming off maybe a 30-minute break from the previous match.
Yeah, I meant maybe even more specifically the Vel'Koz, because it's not that it was extremely destructive to the game, as you said, more of a utility role, but now all of a sudden you also have to keep that in your back pocket and think that the pool might be even deeper for me.
I don't think that the Vel'Koz really did anything in this game. It could be replaced by pretty much any other pick. In fact, Exile probably really liked the fact that he was just winning mid lane by himself. So Vel'Koz really didn't do a whole lot besides just be a really annoying threat for Wave.
And showing a sign that it's frustrating, because Exile, even with doing really well in that lane and getting those pickoffs and important moments in fights, they still can't manage to win off the game of that. So what do they have to adjust going into game two?
I think it's more of picking up more tools, or actually denying tools away from Flash Wolves that allow them to start these fights, like the Kench, like the Ashe. I get what you're saying, Shucks, you know, the fact that even though it essentially was a free lane for Exile, that he wasn't able to do anything anyway, and that Karsa, or excuse me, Maple was still incredibly effective as that secondary support that Seth brought up.
I really find it very difficult to say to let Nidalee go through for Karsa. I mean, this guy was having such an amazing game right there. The play that we saw, the spear was basically half the life of Orianna, and she just randomly disappeared.
Yeah.
And when you have to deal with such a powerful late game threat from the jungle, it's another element that you don't really expect, because she can one-shot you as a carry, and that's something that you don't really expect. You're usually looking out for the CC, for the big carries, and when you have to deal with an extra threat that is so powerful like Nidalee on Karsa, it's just not worth it.
And it's a rather difficult composition, or one of the harder compositions to pull off, that Flash Wolves were playing. The fact that Unicorns Love had so many tools in their kit, like that Kennen, to, you know, get those big engagements, lock them down, but they were never able to find them. MMD, again, the fact that they brought a sub for that guy, but he has just been so potent and so powerful and resetting those fights and creating the space needed for a Nidalee Vel'Koz composition to work.
Yeah, I feel like bringing, you know, having Rins as a possible substitute for Explorer, MMD kind of set a fire under his ass because he's really been playing, like I haven't seen him play in quite some time. This is looking more like 2015 MMD, where I was like, okay, this guy's actually really good, because it was pretty bad moving through. With what little I followed the LMS, it was pretty abysmal moving through the spring and the summer with his performance. So I was happy to hear, like, oh yeah, maybe they have a substitute for him, but he's getting back on form, and that's really good to see.
Yeah, definitely. And for the Flash Rolls, of course, very good confidence boost in the beginning. But we do have to remember also that the Unicorns of Love played earlier today versus TSM. They lost game one, and they did the reverse sweep in a best of three. And this time, they are in a best of five. So we'll see a lot of adaptations coming through for them in game two. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be back with the picks and bans of game two of this final between UL and Flash Rolls right after this.